Professor Dave again, let's talk about cylindrical shells.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We just learned how to find the volume of a solid of revolution by integration, just the way that we calculated the area under a curve by running a line segment of varying length across the region and adding them all up. To get volume, we just ran some area across a shape and added all of those up. Sometimes this was the area of a disk, sometimes the area of a washer. But whatever the situation, we were able to calculate the area of a cross-section rather easily given the functions involved. Sometimes it won't be so easy to use this method, so let's look at an example where another method will be a better approach. Take for example y equals 2x squared minus x cubed. The region between this function and the x-axis looks like this. Let's say we rotate this area around the y-axis to get this bundt cake-looking thing, a solid of revolution. A cross-section of this solid would be a washer, given the empty middle region, which we can then push upwards from the base to the top of the solid. But the problem is this. When we did this before, the functions were simple, like y equals x, or y equals x squared. And given that we are doing things in terms of y, with the previous method, we would have to rewrite the functions in terms of y so that we can integrate. With the other examples, that ended up being no problem, and we were able to get expressions for the inner and outer radii of the washer that we could integrate. Here, it's not so easy. Rather than one function per radius, here both the radii depend on this same function. And furthermore, solving this function for x in terms of y is not a very appealing task. But there is another technique we can try, and it is called the method of cylindrical shells. Before we apply this to the problem at hand, let's just look at this hollow cylinder. This has an inner radius, r1, which ends at the inner face of the solid, and an outer radius, r2, which ends at the outer face. This cylinder also has a height, h. To get the volume of this figure, we can calculate the volume of the cylinder using r2, pretending that it is solid all the way through, and then subtract from that the volume of the inner cylinder using r1, since that's all empty space. The formula for the volume of a cylinder is pi r squared h. So let's do pi r2 squared h minus pi r1 squared h. Factoring out pi and h, we can turn this into pi times the quantity r2 squared minus r1 squared times h. If we remember how to expand a difference of squared terms from algebra, this term is equal to the quantity r2 plus r1 times the quantity of r2 minus r1. Here's the clever bit. Let's take this sum and turn it into an expression for the average value for the radius. To do that, we just divide by 2, but in order to keep the same value for the equation, let's put a 2 at the front. Since this is now the average radius, let's just call it r. Then, over here, the difference between the radii gives us the thickness of the cylinder. So we can call that delta r if we like. And like that, the volume of this cylindrical shell will be equal to 2 pi r h delta r. One easy way to remember this is to see that 2 pi r is the same as the circumference of the cylinder. So this is really just circumference times height times thickness. The reason this is useful is that we no longer have to solve for x in terms of y. If we picture one possible cylindrical shell, it will have a height that is equal to the function f of x, and a circumference equal to 2 pi x. As this shell spans the volume, we then simply have to integrate 2 pi x times f of x dx. In this case, f of x is 2x squared minus x cubed, as we said. So let's plug that in for f of x. And then to simplify, we can take 2 pi out of the integral, but the x must stay, and it can be distributed across the other term. That leaves us with 2 pi times the integral of 2x cubed minus x to the fourth, dx, evaluated from 0 to 2. We integrate to get 2x to the 4th over 4, or 1 half x to the 4th minus 1 fifth x to the 5th. We evaluate at 2, and we get 8 minus 32 fifths, or 40 minus 32 over 5. So we subtract and multiply by 2 pi to get 16 fifths pi. So while this may have seemed complex, part of that is because we derived the formula for the volume of the cylinder. We won't have to do that every time. We just need to know that the volume of the solid with a cylindrical shell oriented vertically will be equal to the integral of 2 pi x times f of x dx over the interval that spans the solid. So we can see that for this particular example, this method ended up being easier than the washer method we used in the previous tutorial, as our formula for the volume of the cylindrical shell was ready to go, which meant we didn't have to do much to set things up. For any solid of revolution you are looking at, whether the cross-section is a disc or washer, you will just have to think critically to figure out which approach is best, depending on whether it is easy to find the radius or radii of the cross-section with the function or functions as given, or whether it is easier to express things another way. For a little practice with this new method, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.